This is Tea Time on Plus TV Africa, where we'll bring you the biggest entertainment stories and very interesting guests as well to analyze them for you. My name is Elsie Godwin, and I have my co-anchors with me, Ife Oluwa Oshonkeye and Ife Omai.
Hello.
It's good morning.
How you doing? Hey,
how's it going?
Oh, we've gone past the dance stage.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
It's a new phase.
Oh.
Things will be different from here on.
I would hope so.
Wow.
You don't have to hope so.
Wow.
Different has not come yet, so let's see.
Mm. Wow.
Nice.
Amazing. Mm. Okay, moving on. We have a guest on standby, so let's get to it. For as long as I can remember, I don't know about you, the proverb, a woman's place in the kitchen, has been used as one of the African proverbs, quote unquote, which upholds our culture. It comes up especially when someone is trying to put down a career-driven woman. But Nigerian musician, singer and the youngest son of the Afrobeat legend Fela Kuti, that Seun Kuti, says this proverb is European and that real Africans elevate the feminine form. In an Instagram post, he said, and I quote, before you start attaching your toxic masculinity to African culture, ask yourself this: do I know African culture? As an African, what cultural practices of African heritage do I engage in? Religion, education, liberation? If the answer is none, how come you want to suddenly become African to subjugate and oppress your woman? And no such thing as halfway crooks. You are either African or you are not. There is no picking and choosing, especially when you want to dump your toxic self on our woman. End of quote. Now joining us to explain this further is Seun Kuti himself. Hi, Seun.
Hello, everybody.
Hi.
How
are you?
We're good. How are you?
I'm fine.
Okay, so tell us, bring us into your well of wisdom. Where did that quote come from?
Oh, the parable. I've always heard that parable. You know, a woman's place is in the kitchen, by, you know, used to justify subjugation of women, you know, in Africa. So I always say to people, you know, yeah, tell me the equivalent in your language. A woman's place is in the kitchen is English. It's not African language. So if this is an African proverb or parable, you must have equivalent or direct translation in your language. You know, I mean, to a certain extent, to even say that in Yoruba makes you sound stupid if you use Yoruba to say it. How are you going to say that? You know, it sounds ridiculous. Mm. You know, absolutely ridiculous, because, you know, to a certain level, etymology and culture, you know, your language and your culture is kind of tied. So things that do not make sense in your people's worldview, it's difficult for you to mouth them in your original language.
Thank
you. Know, because languages also match the scope of the culture, you know?
I really appreciate you writing that, especially coming from a man. I think sometimes it gets lost in translation when a woman is saying it, because, you know, how dare you? Or if a feminist is saying it, she's just angry. But coming from a man, especially like you, who's having such an influence with the males and all of that type of stuff. But I wanted to touch on really quickly with the toxic masculinity. I think that's what really gets people really creative to start bringing up proverbs that don't exist and all that type of stuff. Why do you think, though, that toxic men, because it would be good to address that on TV, why do you think toxic men want a woman who's so domesticated? Like, how does that correlate to toxic masculinity?
Well, you see, toxic masculinity is just a symptom of the larger system of patriarchy, you know. And many people also, erroneously, I might add, believe that patriarchy is also was the African system, you know. But it was not necessarily so that patriarchy was the African system, you know, in the sense that it was in Europe, you know. So many men want to sustain the status quo, especially toxic black men who have imbibed all of this European culture and worldview, and they completely live their life, you know, westernized, or even to, you know, the Arabs and their religion and how they relate with their women. Many of us have also imbibed that spirit, you know, so we want to keep the status quo. Even many of us that are also oppressed just want our way there, because, you know, you have to oppress somebody else.
Yeah.
You keep the
cycle
keep
going.
The status quo. Mm. Exactly. So I think many of them engage in these behaviors because, you know, because they truly, truly, truly are disciples and adherents to this toxic system that that we all survive under, you know. In Africa, I always say to people, it is important that we understand that, yes, we recognize gender, okunrin, obirin, but what we did not recognize was gender roles, right? Yeah. So there was no gender roles. So it's not like a woman cannot be a hunter. It's only men that are this. Mm. There was none of that. Society was completely leveled in the terms of opportunities. You know, so that's why when white people came, you know, they forced our parents to send our
boys,
our women to separate school from our men.
Yeah.
Because it is in European culture that says that women cannot do, that women cannot lead. It is in their culture, not African culture. It is in their religion. Yeah. Women are, even in their religion, you see that God forgot to create women.
Mm.
Women came to God as an afterthought when he saw that Adam was lonely.
Yeah.
Then he said, oh, he needs women. You understand? So people that come from, this is the foundation of their own relationship with the female form as something that is created for their use. So that's why you have boys' school, girls' school, they teach girls home economics, all these so-called female subjects that they taught, and allowed boys go and read physics and chemistry and all of that. And if you see that in European culture, women have to fight for liberation at every step of the way. Hmm. They have to fight to go to school. They have to fight to go to vote. They have to fight to get jobs. They were completely excluded from society. There were no such struggles in Africa where women had to fight to participate in society. You know, our women were kings. They were, in fact, we worship women. I mean, gods and goddess, unlike the European and Arab gods that don't even have wife. No wife, no female angels in the Bible, no female anointed prophet or priest. You know, God don't have a son, you know, not a daughter. Mm. You know, so you have to understand that this is the mindset that create this patriarchy that really dominates this world. And many men benefit from this patriarchal system. Mm. So it's just like people in Nigeria, you know, that instead of them to fight to change the situation of oppression, because they benefit from it, they want to sustain it.
And we keep using the Bible to support this stance as well.
Yeah. I mean, there's evidence of it saying that we should stay mute and everything. But I thank you for answering that. It's obviously we've gone past our teachers. We've become better students than our teachers because we have one of the worst cases of, you know, gender-based violences. Now, I'm not even talking about Nigeria. Now, I'm talking about Africa as a whole. We still have NGM,
genital
mutilations that we don't have anywhere else.
Gender-based violence in Africa is also some kind of propaganda against black African people. Yes, there's gender-based violence. African men, the black men in Africa are abusing our women in monumental proportions. Mm-hmm. But still, it is a global issue.
Yeah.
Women in Asia, women in America, women in Europe. I mean, look at what Obama did in Libya. Look at what women are going through in Libya today because of the atrocity and the havoc that Obama and a woman, Hillary Clinton, created there. But who is speaking to the slavery, the torture, the rape that African women are going through in Libya today? It's completely forgotten, you know. Right. It is not even put in the right context of explanation how these Arabs are treating our women over there, you know. And also I feel that in our society we as a people have a responsibility, not because of violence or rape, but rape culture in its totality must be confronted. We must no longer be afraid, you know, and try and say, oh well, let's be going after individuals that are committing. Let's end the culture of it.
We have because to look at the
individuals that are committing this thing. They stand on on this rape culture. This is what gives them the strength, you know. So when we have men in our society that are willing to exploit the whole of us, you know, exploitation is rape. When we have men in our society that exploit all of us, it is a small step for those people to start exploiting individuals in
Thank you.
Violent forms sexually.
Thank you so much, Sean. This has been
small step.
This has been really enlightening, but for some men that still believe that, some will even tell you that a woman's place is not in the kitchen, but in the other room. So explain to us how African men can elevate their women.
Oh, it is important that we stop using the gender norms of Europe and America to, of European culture or Arab culture to relate with our women. And also, I think it is, as I was saying, this is the point I was actually making on how we elevate our women. How we elevate our women is by removing any culture, any practice, anything that validates their exploitation, their abuse, and their subjugation.
Right.
Okay, so what am I trying to say about that? So, so there are many people in society who are willing to rape our resources, rape nature, rape the country. There are many artists that perform music that insult our women, degrade our women, denigrate our women, but we support these people. You understand? We go to our religious centers where our women are treated as second-class citizens, and we support these things. We need to create an atmosphere where our women are not influenced by this abstract barriers that we have created in our society that continues to keep them, you know, making them feel that they have to be in competition with. African people, we have never been in competition.
Hi,
we live in harmony.
Hello.
See, this is why I say you have to be wise to this capitalist.
Yeah.
When they teach us now, they put in our mind, oh, we have to compete with one another. We have to compete with one another. But when you go and work inside their factory or inside their company, they'll tell you people to work together as a team. Work together as a team for the betterment of the company. Work together as a team for the betterment of your department. But when it comes to our existence, our life, we still should be competing with each other. As if we cannot have the same shared interest.
Shemu, I like your mind. Can you hear me? I like your mind and how it's working. And I know that there are few Nigerians as well, maybe not so few, but we have them who think like you. So
no, I don't think there are few. I think there are a lot of people like me in this country.
Thank
you. They're just excluded. They're excluded from the conversation.
Okay, so how do we include these people in the conversation, and how can they start playing their own role? Because women cannot do it alone. Feminists cannot do it alone. It will take enlightened men like yourself to also talk to younger men, talk to people, and get them to understand what our culture really is and what African stands for. So how do men begin to have these conversations and mentor the ones that don't understand it?
Well, I see, also now you have to see me, I never use the language of division when I'm trying to speak with African people. When I speak with African people, I always want to use the language that envelopes us all in positivity. You understand? So I won't say what I want to teach men to do more. Listen, I feel that the story of Africa is a story of triumphant men and women, or women and men. It's a story of African people. You see, I always say, like, we Africans don't divide ourselves this deep. This kind of division. See, in Yoruba language, I don't know about men, I don't speak any other language. In my language, for example, there's no really one word for son and daughter. It's Omo Kuni, Omo Bini, which is a, you know, you can also mean a boy, can also mean a girl. You know, we don't have all this lady, gentleman, boy, girl, this, that, there, young man, younger, gentleman. You know, these divisions, we don't divide ourselves that deep. So it is a collective effort. The women, they are possibly set it to. How about that? There are toxic women that they themselves perpetuate acts of sexual violence on young people. Yeah. There are also toxic women who enable toxic men.
Yeah. All right, so Sheo, I think this also has a lot to do with upbringing, because you see a lot of parents, when bringing up daughters, they make the boy sit in the living room watching television, and they tell the girl child, go to the kitchen, a woman's place, you should be the one cooking, you should be the one cleaning and all that. So how are you going to advise this new generation parents so that they don't make the same mistake? Because it's a mindset thing. A lot of women, like you said, allow themselves to be subjugated as well. So what would be your advice to parents?
Well, as I said, you know, it's a collective effort. You just hit the nail on the head. So it's not only the father that will be in the house trying to fix the issue. You not only the mother that will be in the house trying to fix the issue. Both the father and the mother have to come to some kind of conscious agreement that they are not going to infect their children with the same virus that they were infected with. So you see how that simply explains that both the men and the women, both also, this toxic thing, the line will be broken in our generation.
Amen.
We will not carry it forward. So it is a collective effort of both sides. You see, this is one of the arguments I always have with feminists, because me, I'm an Africana womanist. See, there's another ideology entirely brought up by black women, grounded in African worldview about the healing of the sexes. But it is not gaining prominence, as I told you. Everybody wants to be feminist.
Tell us about the Africana ideologist. Tell us about the one you talk about.
Africana womanist.
Is that it?
Yeah, Africana womanism. Okay, well, it's simply you can go online and check it out. I've forgotten the one of the leaders, the woman that wrote the original text. I have it on my book that I read. So basically, she's saying, because she was in the Black Panther Party, and she witnessed a lot of toxic masculinity in a so-called vanguard African organization like the Black Panther, where many of our heroes in America were members and leaders of. So she said, while they were there, they realized that they had to create something within the organization that started to teach their brothers how to be proper men. So now this for me was relevant in one simple sense, that was not saying, oh, these black men are bad, so do away with them. For me, it was saying our brothers are worth the healing. And that is what the world is hiding from black people today. We make ourselves feel as if we are not worthy of each other's love, understanding, and forgiveness. We make ourselves feel as if black people do not deserve each other's comfort, each other's attention. The division is just crazy in my own mind when I see it, you know? Because even in our relationship, if a boy loves a girl and is willing to do everything for his African girlfriend and he's falling head, his friends will start to yabbing. Look at you, mumu, woman rapper, this, that. I don't understand this toxicity. Same thing, if a girl loves a guy, Nigerian man, are you love, but they do this one. But many of those people, let them get white lovers now. Their friends will be the ones falling head over heels to keep the white lover comfortable and feel welcome. You understand? So we don't extend to ourselves these basic humanities. You understand? We want to counsel each other. We are willing to. No, this is not how we heal. So Africana womanism basically was saying there's internal healing, there's value in healing each other internally. Because one of the things is that people say, oh, the way we treat our women, how can we not be saying white people don't? Internal aggression or internal disputes does not justify external aggression. So me and my brother are fighting does not give you the right to come and burn our father's house down. You understand? You know? So for me, it is a collective effort. It is something that we have to become deliberate about. It's just like our liberation. It's just when people say, oh, Sean, you are so active. Well, you read too much. It's not because I read that I'm active. It is because I've decided to become deliberate about my liberation, deliberate about my existence. I realize that I can no longer afford to just be living life.
Thank you so much, Shimo. I mean, when we are doing things like this, time is never on our side. But we hope to have you again sometime to talk more about
this. No problem, anytime.
All right, thank you.
But it's everybody's effort. We need to root out all toxicity and not encourage it. We cannot validate, especially people that profit from it. When we engage with people that profit from toxicity, we should cancel them. But for some reason, in black society, we elevate them to the top. The R. Kelly's, Bill Cosby's, Nigerian politicians, you know, and all these.
Harvey Weinstein's.
Thank you, Sean, again. We'll catch up with you later.
Cheers.
Thank you.
Okay, that was
very interesting.
And I hope that people listen. and learn, because I know so many men. I mean, I know I use the word few for people like Shion, but deep down, I think they are actually fewer than the other people we are trying to make understand what this is really about. And I like when he said that the Africana womanism. I like when he said it's about understanding that the men are worth healing, and it's not just about counseling them, or it's about forgiveness and acceptance and understanding that they have also been oppressed in a way, in a sense. So unfortunately we have to go, but do you want to say one or two?
I liked everything that he said, especially with the Africanism, whatever that you mentioned. I think it still all boils down to what's it called, you know, equality for everyone and all. But the difference between that and feminism, that it's unarguable even from a feminist, is that we don't concentrate necessarily on Africa. And I think that's what's really beautiful about that. For me, as a person living in a imbalance, even in a man's world, I think I've done the selfish, which is what he's preaching, like the selfish method of like, for myself. So if that means I rubbish Africa, not rubbish, but like push Africa aside and focus on someone else that will better me, I will do that. Instead of like really focusing on the African man and the African culture and the African people, I don't think we do that. And I know feminism doesn't do that. It focuses more on gender, wherever you're from. So this is a lot more focused. And I think that hits the hill harder on the head, because Africans have a different culture, even as women.
I think the best points that he made out of this was that it is a collective effort. So we can't keep saying that it is the man's job to do this, it is the woman's job to do this.
There's no gender role.
So we all have to come together, put our hands, all hands on deck, and let's make this world a better place.
Thank you.
Okay, that's an amazing conversation, and that's how we wrap up this episode of Tea Time. Thank you for watching, and do send your own opinion via WhatsApp to 0906000 5719, or tweet at us at @PlusTVAfrica. Remember, you can catch up on this episode and all our exclusive content by subscribing to our YouTube channel at @PlusTVAfrica. Also, watch Tea Time on Arrow TV and in London on Ben Television. My thank you, as always, to go to my interesting co-anchors, Ife Omai and Ife Oluwa
Oshunkeya. Yes, that's me.
And the entire production team. Thank you for watching Plus TV Africa's Tea Time. My name is Elsie Godwin. Please do stay safe.